ahorita ya se han visto en estos momentos. Los horarios son sumamente puntuales. Entonces, el punto de las 2:30 de la tarde. Empiezan a escuchar los motores.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Pit exit is green. Qualifying session for GT cars has started.
Sydney Aston Martins. It's Darren Turner aboard the 97, of course, both two driver squads, these cars now. The 95 Nicky team emerges second position. Pedro Lamy is already aboard the, or was aboard rather, of course, the number 98 car. So 97, 95, 51, 77 Porsche, Michael Christensen, the latest down pit road, 71 Ferrari, then the 66 Ford, and still no first flying lap time for the number 67 Ford. If you've joined us late, that's because the car's been down pit lane twice now with the left-hand door open. In comes Ben Barker. And he is not the last person to pit, but Ben pits from third position in GTM. So the spread, the cars we've seen so far, with Andy Priot just putting in a time, is, I'm afraid, the slowest in the class at the moment. It's 1.566 seconds between the seven Pro cars, 1.3 seconds between the six AM cars, 140.134 for the number 97 car, the best of the session so far. 42.009, the best for Pedro Lamy, who brings the 98 car in provisional pole at this stage down pit road to hand over the car to Paul Dallolana. So again, to remind regular viewers and to inform all those new people joining in the fun with the WEC this year, that the amateur, the Pro-Am formulae, that means GTE Am in this session, LMP2 to come, the non-professionally ranked driver must be one of the two qualifying drivers, and the qualifying time is an average of one fast lap time each, the fastest of their time in the car between both drivers. So a real team game here, and it's up the ante for the non-professional drivers, John, in GTE Am and LMP2 over the last couple of seasons. So out and into the race, or into the session, Paul Dallolana. Ben Barker will hand over to Mike Wainwright in the 86 car. And trouble again for the 67. They are not having a good time at all. Andy Priot coming into the stadium, and oh dear me, and hit the barrier. The car got a real wiggle on into that, what's actually a very quick right-hander, and overcooked it. Car wiggled, gripped, and then smacked into the barrier driver's left.
Thank you very much to our hard-working technical team here who have connected Graham Goodwin and me, John Hindorf, to the outside. Well, what you've missed, actually, is about five or six major exclusives for sports car racing.
Astonishing.
For next year. But now we've been told we can't repeat those, so they're gone forever.
Very sorry.
Gone. Sorry. Very sorry. And a half minutes left. Only joking. Yeah. Only joking. Thank you very much to the guys at WEC TV for sorting that little issue out. And delighted to know that you are listening to us again. That's just coming into the stadium section, isn't it?
Yep, he's just got it wrong there. Clipped.
That was coming back on after turn 12.
Indeed.
That is Sam Bird down there looking. Let's give you the rundown as it stands at the moment. It's the usual two laps from two drivers are averaged out. Nicky team has provisional pole at the moment in the 95 Aston Martin from Darren Turner in the 97. They've been both very quick right across the weekend. There's 2.25 tenths, 2.5 tenths between them. And it's Aston Martin for a whitewash at the moment with Paul Dallolana's 142.009 in the AM class. Mike Rainwright just going out. And Khaled El Kabezi, James Collado, and Richard Leitz going very quickly.
Well, Richard Leitz very close indeed to the Ferrari. By the way, the two Aston Martins, the second drivers in both now, Nicky Team and Darren Turner. Nicky Team has extended the gap to about a quarter of a second over his teammates. We're still waiting for first lap times from the second drivers in the remainder of the field, with the exception of Stefan Mucha, who's pitted the 66 car now. So it's not looking like a great session so far for the four performance guys, the Chip Ganassi Racing guys. Looking great for Aston Martin. 6 minutes remain. Glorious sound of that Aston Martin V8 coming down now past us our commentary position and to start another quick lap. That was Darren Turner in the number 95, Nicky Team in the number 95 car. No improvement that time around for Nicky. Darren Turner, though, has closed the gap. Now back down to, a tenth and a half on average. And they've got a half a second gap over James Collado's best effort. So where are the improvements going to come? Well, let's see what Rickard Leitz can do. Paul Delalana, meanwhile, at the moment, the fastest man in the second driver slot, so that's looking good for Aston Martin being on top in GTE AM. The number 98 car on the timing screen is currently ranked as second, but that's because Mike Wainwright in the 86 car has not yet posted his first flying lap. Just as it now, maintains his third position overall in that car. Nicky Team, meanwhile, is pushing on and looking to improve. He's gone quicker than he's gone before in the first sector. 4.5 minutes remain. Aston Martin 1-2, then Ferrari, Porsche, Ford, Davide Rigon, 71 Ferrari, and then the 66 Ford.
So 4.25 minutes to go, and it's an Aston Martin greenwash at the moment.
It is 1-2 in GTE Pro, and dominantly so as well, John. It's a big gap there. It's going to take something pretty special from anybody else in the field to come to terms with that. The spread across the seven Pro cars.
Let's head down to Louise Beckett, who is with Sam Bird for Ferrari. Louise.
Yes, Sam, we were speaking earlier, and you were saying it's going to be hard to match those Aston Martins. What can you do here?
If they're reliable, it's an impossible job to catch them. They're on another level. The best that we can realistically do on pace is P3 and P4. Even that's very tough at the moment. It's very difficult with the straight line speed of the Astons. They're 10k quicker than us.
We knew altitude could be an issue here. Have you got any idea why the turbos aren't performing so well?
Not really, no. That's for the engineers to know, and we need to find out, but for sure the normally aspirated seem to have a big advantage here.
Thank you.
Well, so far we've had four drivers who've managed to get under 141. Both the first drivers in the Aston Martins, Nicky Team in the 95 Aston Martin, and James Collado has ducked under 141 as well. All the rest of the times, with one exception thus far, are in the 141s in the GTE Pro class. That exception being Harry Tinknell getting up to speed now in the 67. So it looks to me, John, as if the number 95 and number 97 Aston Martins have called it a day. They've got the gap they believe can't now be caught. The best of the rest. James Collado and Jimmy Bruni in the number 51, a troubled car so far this season, Ferrari 488. This is the number 83. They, of course, a Ferrari, seems to be suffering this weekend, more than the team expected, with the atmospherics here, with the power loss that you get at altitude. But the car seems to be struggling with something else over and above that, and is not squeezing the kind of speeds out, the kind of power out of the car that the team were expecting here in Mexico City. Bright sunshine now around the circuit. Something we perhaps expected this morning, and a gathering crowd. It's a working day, of course. Gathering crowd for this Friday. Tune in tomorrow for the race, and I think you're going to see that baseball stadium pretty well packed. That's going to be some sight with these cars powering through. Francois Perodo bringing the 83 car. This, remember, the championship leading car, Christian Reed in the very attractively liveried blue and white KCMG car, prepared by Christian's Proton Competition team. entered under Paul Ipps, KCMG banner. 48 seconds remain, and difficult to see at the moment where those any improvements going to come from the major runners. Certainly Aston Martin think they've done enough.
They will be absolutely over the moon, to use another sporting metaphor, which is particularly apposite here with all the different sports being represented. The Autodromo Amando Rodriguez now in the Park of Sporting Excellence, effectively. Very
absolutely
similar
right.
to a few years ago when I was in Thailand for the Race of Champions. They had that in the Ramanganjala Stadium, which was also their sporting centre, national sporting centre. The baseball stadium here is for the Mexican national team, and the checkered flag is out, by the way.
And
Ford comes straight into the pit lane without coming past the line as the C67. Yep. Now, this will be bitter goal for Ford, because in the free practice, the third free practice session, they were much closer to the top of the field than they'd been at any other time. And now they find themselves at the bottom of the GTE Pro ranks. And I don't feel they will think they've done themselves any justice there.
No.
But teams that have, it is a lockout. The Empire has struck back, with Great Britain in first and second on the Pro class, and
there you have it, both pole position cars.
In the AMCAR as class as well, has the pole position. So brilliant stuff for Aston Martin. Nicky team closest to us there. This is going to be very interesting indeed. KCMG Porsche was the last car. Still a couple of cars still to come through.
This could, if this form is replicated in the race tomorrow, John, put a real cat amongst the pigeons in the championships.
Massively. Absolutely, massively, Graham.
Now, we said a lot of, you know, unknowns here. There have been some surprises for the teams.
How is the 77 car going?
We'll come home fourth.
Well,
actually, is he going to be... No, just gets fourth.
Just fourth. Stays in fourth, yes.
I think they'll be disappointed with that.
Yeah, I think too. Aston have trimmed the cars out there ridiculously quick in a straight line, and by quite some margin quicker than the rest of the field. Nicky team will be a very, very happy day indeed, as Louise is about to sit speak to our pole sitter.
Well, they were you've been strong all weekend so far. You've got to be pleased with that.
Yeah, we are second time in a row P1, so I hope we can hold it this time. We're definitely going to bring it to Ferrari and Ford this time. Until now, we've been struggling, but now we've got some good pace around here. So, new track, and it's a pleasure to come here and start P1 tomorrow.
Do you feel like you've got to grips with the track? You know it now, you can handle it for tomorrow?
Yeah, we got extra practice yesterday, so that was kind of us all. So, I'm sure we are good, and we worked a lot on the setup and so on, so the guys have been doing a good job. And yeah, 6 hours tomorrow in this this track, this area, is going to be tough on man and machine, so looking forward to it.
Thanks very much, Adam.
You talked about the unknowns, Graham. One of the unknowns is fuel usage here.
Very
long
much
runs.
So.
You've got the pole.
Yeah, it's true. We made another pole. It's nice. It's nice. A new track. Nice track. Difficult. Different than what we're used to. But we are on first for tomorrow. We'll see. It's a long race. Hopefully, we can have a good race.
I'm going to leave you because you've got a photo call right behind you. Thanks.
Well,
notice, Graham, the Mexican flag colours on the Aston Martin wings there behind the guys. Mateus Lauda, the only one not dressed, of course, because he knew he wasn't going to be needed with only two drivers required. So the 98 car driver. And those enamel wings are on the the bonnet, the nose of each of the three Aston Martins. Confirmation there then, 95 and 97 on pole position from AF Corsa number 51. Then the 77 Dempsey Proton Racing car. I think you're right. I think they'll be disappointed. They've split the AF courses. That would be a good result for them normally, but it's not what we expected given the first three practice sessions here and the two Fords. Well, unless there's something going on that we don't know about, I think they'll be desolate about that. That's a gap they weren't expecting to see. And I mean, what do you say? It's a brilliant return to form for the 98 car again.
It is, Sean, and it's also important to stress that, look, there is, okay, it's a single point for each of these pole position cars, but that's a big result for the 95 team because they now closed within 4 points of the championship lead, and that is the Ford. And if that form is repeated tomorrow in the race, the 66 Ford and the 71 Ferrari, which finished the session way down as well, are going to be in big trouble. And this could see a real upset in the current form in the GTE Pro class. In GTE AM, it could be even more dramatic because at the moment, runaway leaders there are the number 83 AF Corsa Ferrari team. They were nowhere and they've been struggling all weekend. If they repeat that form in the race, the current, I think it's 41 points, well, 40 with the point for the number 98 car, which finished on pole position, is second in the championship. That starts to get it sort of within reach, doesn't it?
It does.
It makes a massive difference if you've got a 15-point difference and a 40-point difference into four flyaway races where anything can, will and always does happen.
So, prototypes coming out next, Graham. And do you know what? I honestly don't know what to expect because we've seen a topsy-turvy week so far.
There's the Mexican flag flying high and proud on the rear wing, the dorsal fin of the RGR Sport Bomber and car. Bruno Senna at the wheel.
And Tequila Patron on that car, yes, which I've not seen.
Yes, their sponsor here for this weekend because this is the home race for Tequila Patron, of course. We recognise the Extreme Speed Motorsports team as a American team, but Tequila Patron is a Mexican company.
Okay. As I said, the week has been topsy-turvy, but if what we've just seen in the GT categories is anything to go by, we can't go with anything that we've seen because it could all be turned upside down again. This is one of the things that we actually love about this form of racing is that nothing is set in stone. Paul Truswell, when I ask him any questions, our walking data centre, the walking data centre, he always says, if everything else remains the same, and in this form of racing, that seldom happens.
Well, just another quick look there at another interesting entry for this weekend. It's a one-off entry it's the car that won the European Le Mans Series last year from Greaves Motorsport. We'll talk about that in a little moment, because here's another interesting one. This is the 44 car at Pit Inn, the garage closest to Pit Inn. A solo entry this weekend from Manor Motorsports with the 44 car, but with two drivers who habitually have been in the 45.
Yeah.
We'll talk, I'm sure, during the weekend about the reasons why it's one car. Both Extreme Speed Motorsport Ligier Nissans there too, and both of the Signatec entered Alpines there. This could be real cat amongst the pigeons time, and here's a very interesting one to watch, because Straka Racing this weekend, two non-professional ranked drivers, so they can run with Lewis Williamson and Johnny Kane.
Yes. Yeah, Nick Leventis and Lewis Williamson both ranked as silver drivers, and there is Lewis in the car right now. Yeah. SMP.
And how many stories here? What is going to happen with SMP Racing?
You told me the other day, 8 chassis.
They do.
8 BR01 chassis built, 4 of them here.
4 of them here. There is a spare chassis for each of these entries, the 27 and the 37. But it does strike me as at the moment it's a team that is in some trouble moving forward. We wait to see what happens with SMP Racing beyond this year. But it doesn't seem at the moment to be a particularly happy camp.
Remind me, because I do get confused easily, I am a bear, a very small brain. The SMP chassis, the BR01s, they would be still allowed in Asian Le Mans series next year, and they would be relatively competitive there, would they?
They'd be allowed here, but grandfathered. They wouldn't be competitive. Okay. They'd be allowed in the LMS. They wouldn't be competitive against the new Gibson engine cars with 100 horsepower more.
And indeed in IMSA, presumably, as well.
And yes, in IMSA, I believe so as well, a grandfather, but wouldn't be competitive. But certainly for Asian Le Mans until 2019, the cars would be effectively the top class.
Just for a moment, I thought we were going to get a Mexican wave.
That would be good, wouldn't
yes,
it?
Yes, absolutely.
Bit of news from up and down the pit, Blaine, for those joining us for the first time this weekend. Been a troubled start to the weekend for Toyota.
Massively so.
With both cars, in fact, very different reasons. The six car had a big shunt in the collective test with Stefan Sarrazin. He's fine. He's going to be out in the car.
Coming out of the corner that you're looking back at now, the final corner.
30 over the seconds to open pit lane. Under 30 seconds to open pit lane for qualifying. Of the LMP cars. Again, I call your attention to the respect of track limits.
Coming out the final corner, the Peraltada, and caught the curb on the outside, sent Stefan into the inside wall, very reminiscent of Alayor back in 88, but without the getting airborne bit.
5, 4.
Here's Eduardo.
3, 2, 1. Pit exit is green. Pit exit is green.
No mistakes again.
All the way from 10 to 1.
That's fantastic.
The upshot of that is the number 6 car is not the same car that started the week.
Yeah, it is.
They
new chassis.
Missed FP1 and FP2. And the guys had basically a very long day and night yesterday transferring the important bits from a very broken chassis to a brand new chassis that was the spare. And then. Hot on the heel of that for the other car.
Then on the hot of the heels of that, number 5 car, I'm afraid, has lost the services of Anthony Davidson for this week, because Ant tried the car in the collective's test session, but has given best to rib injuries he suffered in what I believe was an enormous testing shunt at Manicor last month.
30G, I heard.
Yes, indeed. He's not fit. He's perfectly fine, aside from having very sore ribs, but not going to be in competitive form. And then on top of that, further news earlier today, that another of the factory LMP1 cars will be a two-man squad, because Benoit Trelluet, again, who had a go in the car, we believe, earlier this weekend, has declared himself not fit to take part in the race aboard the 7 Audi. So all sorts of dramas for the factory teams.
I knew McNish would regret. McNish and Pirro are here this weekend as Audi ambassadors. Now, Pirro does still have a race licence. Alan has not. Not being called upon, of course. They've run that car with two drivers last time out. All right, we're on underway. 20 minutes, two drivers, fastest times, average together, sets the grid. Love this qualifying setup. So that was Brendan Hartley waiting in the pit lane. So who's in the number one? Oh, that's odd.
That was Brendan Hartley.
That must have been Mark Leib, yes. My apologies.
Well, before we get into this, because it's going to get fast and furious very, very fast indeed, one to look out for if you're watching live timing and have got the timing, the speed trap, is the Rebellion. Because by a country mile, that car is the fastest thing in a straight line.
327, we've seen a couple of times.
So 204 miles an hour to break the timing beam. A lot quicker than anything else out there.
Right, here's the number one Porsche. He's about halfway around the track at the moment. Coming into the S's at the back of the circuit. Beautiful rhythm section here. And then onto the short straight. After this bit here, this is where the track limits have been getting called on the outside here. That's turn 11. Now onto the back straight of the oval. And we've swapped cars to the 43. And where's he on the circuit? Come out of turn 6, that is. So a little bit further back down the circuit. CDMX, by the way, stands for Mexico City.
Should say all 19 cars across the two classes are out on track at the moment. First fast laps going to the pair of Porsches. 125.045 to Neil Jenny. 3/10 up on Brendan Hartley.
Right, here's Kaz Nakajima across the start line. Gets out the paperback novel that he brought with him, reads a couple of chapters as he goes sharp end of kilometre and a half down to the braking area for the Monza Solana S's. Turns 1, 2 and 3 coming in quick succession. Oh, and this is back onto the on board with the 7 car. That's Andrea Lotterer, who's just got quickest with the 24-7.
First man into the 124s, and Andrea Lotterer has raced here in the circuit in a previous configuration back in 2002 in Champ Car, one off with Delcoin Racing.
He's also raced on the oval configuration here in Formula E, hasn't he?
Absolutely right.
Yes. So this is looking back from turn one. From turn one, two and three, it goes slightly downhill down the Trocera Strait, down towards the Largo S's, the Lake S's, four, five and six. Then through that serpentine section on the oval straight and then into turn 12, which takes you into the stadium. And it is really a stadium. Phenomenal place.
First flying lap set for all the LMP1 cars, and it's Lotterer from Gianni, Hartley, Duval, Mike Conway, Kaz Nakajima, then Dom Kreihammer, then Simon Trummer in the CLM, topping out, ending up the eight. Neil Gianni is pitted. After just one flying lap, Neil Gianni is bringing the number two car down pit road. This was a car that had some problems this morning, John.
Yeah, correct.
In P2, meanwhile, this
is the Porsches, in fact, were
indeed
in.
Indeed, they were.
And out of the garage a couple of times. They were trying to dial out some fairly excessive understeer.
And also down pit road, Mike Conway in the number six Toyota. In P2, it's Gustavo Menezes leads the times at the moment, in the number 36 Citytech Alpine from Lewis Williamson. Cracking lap there from Lewis. And a bit of spin, meanwhile, for the number 30 Extreme Speed Motorsport car. They've continued. Bruno Senna, third quickest. Richard Bradley in the Manor, 44, fourth. Then Roman Rusinov in the 26. Victor Scheitar in the first of the SMP BR1s. Bruno Junquera in the Greaves car. Johannes van Overbeck, it was, had that quick spin. Nick Manassian in the 27. David Cheng in the 35 Baxi DC Alpine. And Chris Cumming at the moment propping up the order. But he is an amateur driver out there with very many of the professionals. So that could be a bit of a topsy-turvy time. Duval going quickly at the moment. Andrea Lotterer, time not been bettered so far. The only man into the 124s, 14 minutes remain. And are there tactics going to be in play here with a couple of very quick pit stops? And Neil Gianni has not so far left pit road, neither yet has Mike Conway, nor any replacement driver. Brendan Hartley pits the number one Porsche now. So some quick fire pit stops coming here very early in the session.
Well, I wonder if they want to get two quick laps in from the drivers and then see where they're going to go from there. Or are they saving tyres? Remember, tyre allocation is a factor, although this being a new event, of course, they'll get an extra set.
Look, Duval, meanwhile, has now split the Porsche, so it's out, he's one and three. New tyres we can see now going on the number one Porsche. Meantime, in LMP2 land, Bruno Senna looking to improve and does so, goes to the provisional pole. That'll be very popular with the local audience here. The RGR Sports Ligier goes through for another lap now. Doesn't better the time he'd set. It's 134.688 for Senna. That's a full second up on the best time of Gustavo Menezes. Bruno Junquera, meanwhile, puts the Greaves Gibson third. So looking very good at the moment for the cars sporting local colours, and a brake fire by the look of it on the CLM at the left rear.
Let's just hope that what it is, because that car has been prone to spontaneous combustion, overly prone to spontaneous combustion. The smoke signals coming from the pit lane on the left-hand side are not good, although the team are still there. It does look like it's just coming from the left wheel area.
It's not the same area we've seen the problems before with what we think was a heat exchanger issue for that car. So Lotterer pits the provisional pole sitting Audi now, as Mark Lieb is now out on track in the number two Porsche.
Looks like the Audis both will get new Michelins as they come in, also into the pit lane. Toyota number five.
And that is, of course, the car with the two-man driver squad.
Now, this is interesting with the drivers. Kaz Nakajima just having a chat there.
Seb Buemi.
To Seb Buemi as he's going to get into the car. Probably just handing him a little bit of information about how the car's handling. At the meantime, Bruno Junquera will be able to tell his teammate that's the back end of the number 41 Gibson this weekend in a brand new Mexican flag livery. Is a little lively.
Yeah, this
another great shot down into the stadium. That's turn 12.
Absolutely, and Greaves Motorsport working hard to be back in the WEC next year. We'll wait and see what happens with that. Lots and lots and lots of LMP2 news in particular kicking around, as you might expect with the formula changing for the year. Chinquera brings the 41 car back down the pit road after that moment. So Marcel Fesler it is, tasked with defending that lead on the timing sheets for the number 7 Audi. So it's 7 Audi from 2 Porsche, just under 11 minutes to go. Then the 8 Audi, Mark Webber now aboard the number 1 Porsche in 4th, Seppo Amy and Kamumi Kobayashi aboard the 2 Toyotas, and it's Alexander Imperatori that will take out the Rebellion to set the second time there. In P2, Bruno Senna now on pit road, together with Gustavo Menezes. They're done and 1-2 for those two drivers. Richard Bradley is in the number 44 Manor car that's just gone up into third spot. Bruno Jonquera, despite that issue out on track, fourth. Lewis Williamson still out on track, is fifth. Yet to see the 26 car sits behind the Stracker car in the order. Roman Rusinov has been in for the first part of the session, almost inevitably, and there's a big wiggle there for the number 6 car. Very committed run through the S's from Kamui Kobayashi. We'll see to what effect very soon. Quick first sector, but no improvement for that car. Marcel Fesler, due through any time now. As we wait for second driver time to come through, the first of those has gone to Mark Lieb. He's put in 125 as well. Kobayashi's best so far, 127.
Just over 9 minutes to go. Bruno Senna in the 43 leads P2. And it's Marcel Fesler in the 7 leading P1.
It's a 1.9 second split across the LMP1 hybrids at the moment, with the Toyotas with ground to make up.
Yeah, they were about a second back in FP3 this morning, weren't they?
Yep.
And half a second away from the Porsches, which were in front of them. Or the Porsche that was in front of them.
A less significant split as they come to the end of the sessions for the first P2 drivers is 3.7 seconds. Why less significant? Because some of the teams opted to start their non-professional driver.
Number 2 in the pit lane, Mark Lieb, in that car when it came in, and another set of tyres going onto that, according to Louise Beckett.
Audi 1-2, Lucas de Grassi goes ahead of the Porsche, but not for very long.
No, here's Mark Webber coming out at the end of the lap. Meantime, this is the number 2 Audi, the number 2 Porsche, should I say.
I'm going to correct myself. Lucas de Grassi has not set a flying lap time. That
no,
is by dint of the fact. But Lucas de Grassi has gone through the first sector fastest of all, improved his second sector time.
So currently, it's actually Porsche 1-2.
It is.
Because the number 8 Audi hasn't put his second driver lap in yet.
I think that's for about for another 5 seconds.
Was that tyre squeal?
It is tyre squeal.
That's out to 16, which is coming out of the stadium into the...
Wow.
Paraltada.
First man in the 124s there for Lucas de Grassi. It's, in fact, second man, sorry, in the 124s.
Marcel
Fesler has...
24.763 for Fesler is the fastest lap.
No, that's not Fesler's time. That's the fastest time for the car. So both Audis have now set a 124. Lucas de Grassi, the moment the wheel number 8, that goes through to provisional pole. Marcel Fesler has got time to make up, but has a very good first driver lap time to build on. De Grassi, Lieb, Webber, Fesler, Buemi, Kobayashi at the moment. And in LMP2, it's the 43 car. Ricardo Gonzalez now at the wheel of that car. Nico Lapierre now at the wheel of the 36 car, with the first session on the wheels of Gustavo Menezes. Richard Bradley has brought the number 44 Manor car in. I suspect it was Matt Rao to go back out. and Roberto Gonzalez, so both the Gonzalez brothers at the moment in the top four. Roberto for Greaves.
Which was at low speed, so I didn't get any vibration, but there's one lock up on the front left.
So that's the Dunlop tyre technician that Bruno was talking to there.
So at the moment, the picture is Porsche. Not afraid to put tyres on these cars.
No.
What can Marcel Fesler do about putting a wall of Audi ahead of the Porsches? So 125.069 is the average of the two drivers so far in the provisional pole sitting number 8 Audi R18. That is quarter of a second to the good of the average of the chasing two Audi, 4 tenths, in fact 3.5 tenths now, with an improvement for Mark Webber that time around in time but not position. So about 3.5 tenths back on average is Mark Webber aboard the number one Porsche, and a further tenth to Marcel Fesler in the number 7 Audi, 6 Toyota and the 13 Rebellion pit. Nothing more to prove, I think, in this session for the Rebellion crew.
No.
Pierre Caffer, though, has rejoined the session. And some quick sector times coming in now. We might be about to see some improvements here. Looking for an improvement from a 124.8 from Lucas Degrassi. A 125.5, the best at the moment for Mark Lieb. A 125.4 for Mark Webber, and a 126.2 for Marcel Fesler. Meantime, can the fairy tale pole position happen for the 43 Orica?
That's a story, isn't it? That'll put a few thousand on the gate tomorrow.
If there's any tickets left.
It's a fair point you make there, Grim, because not all of the grandstands are going to be open.
No. Hearing from Louise down the pits that the number 6 has changed back to first driver for that car. Stefan Sarrazin has indeed rejoined in that car. Marcel Fesler, 4 minutes to go. Has come into the pit lane, come down the pit lane. Lucas Degrassi too. Oh, and it's 4 minutes trouble to go. Trouble for one of the Alpines. Is that the 35 car?
It's the 36.
And that was Nico Lapierre chasing pole position.
It's turn 7, Graham.
Red flag, pretty immediately.
And it will stop the clock. It will mean there'll be one more flying lap available.
Now, could that be significant for any of the other runners here?
7 and 8 with new sets at the ready. Lucas Degrassi being pushed back down the pit. Let's head down to Lou. This has thrown a spanner in the works of a number of teams. Nico is running again. Lou?
Yeah, definitely. The number 8 had just come in, and 7. They've all got new tyres. Both of them have got new sets of tyres on, and they're now having to wait.
Well,
at least they hadn't gone out and wasted a lap on the tyres.
Indeed. So the number 36 car is underway, but will have damage, I think, to that rear wing. It clouted the barrier and indeed has got rear damage on the right-hand side. So can't say there could be any improvement from the 36 car. That will help the efforts of the 43 car. It was Nick Lapierre chasing down that 43, the RGR Sport Ligier, for pole position. I think lost the car after clobbering the curb there, John. So Gonzalez in the 43 from Lapierre. Rennie Rast making his way, as he traditionally does, up the order. Could this be the first race that we don't see the 26 on pole position?
Mm-hmm. Well, this is not going to be a long red flag, Graham, I'll tell you that now.
I absolutely agree, and my guess is they will allow all the cars to come into pit lane and then restart the session, including, of course, the not quite stricken, but certainly not quite straight at the moment, 36. So what are the gaps? Tiny gap, actually, for pole position. It's 42 thousandths of a second is the gap between the number 8 Audi and the number 2 Porsche. They will clearly be making a determination as to which of the two drivers can improve more easily. It's Brendan Hartley is back aboard the number one car. So they put Brendan back in the car to see what he can do about the three-tenths of a second gap to the number one car. That's making its way there. It's Mark Lieb is climbing out of the number two car. And there didn't appear to be another driver ready for that. And almost the last car back in is the 43 of Ricardo Gonzalez, at the moment sitting on provisional pole position in the race. He has been the promoter and organiser for, working hand in glove with the FIWC. All the cars back now on pit road. Cheers for Gonzalez.
Of course there are. And, you know, that is a new rear end going on to the Alpine.
Now, what a story this would be.
One flying lap. You've got one lap, Nico, one lap.
Now, what do you do here? Do you leave Ricardo Gonzalez in the car? Do you put Bruno Senna back in? What do you do? Last throw of the dice. The gap.
Well, who can improve most? The third. Who was out first?
It was
Bruno. 34-6 against the 36-7. You put Ricardo out on a new set of tyres. If you haven't already given him a new set of tyres.
Well, heroics potentially to come here. The session will restart in a minute's time. So it's 1 minute before we get the cars back underway.
And it's going to be like a cavalry charge.
The cars at the end of pit road. This is Porsche making it pretty clear they want to go out there and do something about this. Let's go through those gaps, John. The gap from the provisional pole sitting number 8 to the second placed number 2. We've not yet seen which driver is at the wheel of that car, but Mark Lee certainly got out. So it's my guess is that car has gone back to Neil Janney. 42 thousandths of a second, 3 tenths of a second back to the number 1 Porsche, 4.5 tenths back to the number 7 Audi.
30 seconds to open pit lane, under 30 seconds to open pit exit to resume the qualifying session.
Stand by for action. They may get two flying laps
15
here.
15 seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Pit exit is green. Pit exit is green.
So Ricardo Gonzalez stays aboard the 43. Loic Duval climbs aboard the number 8 to see what he can do about defending that provisional pole position. Porsche quick off the blocks to restart this session. 3 minutes and 20 seconds remain. There's going to be dramas here. I've zero doubt about it. Going to be dramas and there's going to be change. So for Loic Duval, he now needs to better a 1:25.3. That is the slower of the two times for the drivers in the number 8. It was a quicker time in the second part of the session from Lucas Degrassi. It's Neil Janney has got back aboard. So the first driver back aboard the 2 and the 1. But Marcel Fessler stays aboard the number 7 car. Game on for this. Any of those drivers perfectly capable of putting in a time that could put either one of the Audis or one of the Porsches on pole position for the 6 hours of Mexico. For Gonzalez, though, he must feel a little bit like he's under fire with Nico Lapierre back out aboard the number 36, René Rast, the man who has helped G-Drive to 4 consecutive pole positions so far this season aboard the 26, and the gaps. 2 tenths to Lapierre, 3 tenths on average across the two drivers, remember, for Rast. 2 minutes left. Porsches go by. The 31 ESM Ligier, Pippa Durrani, trying to lift that car up from next to bottom, I'm afraid, at the moment, in the standings in LMP2. And it will be, for all the cars coming through at the moment, two flying laps. First, them not to actually go through at a pace that should see that through is the SMP 27 car. The 43 will not get two flyers.
just on a minute to go. Got to get across the line now.
Johnny Kane will get a second lap.
Right, remember, these outlaps don't count.
This is
That's not going to be any good to anybody right now.
This is slide laps now. Oh, he's lost it.
That's number two. Massive off from Neil Jarny into turn 12, and he's gone wide again so that he doesn't spoil the lap of his teammate coming through. Really heads-up play from the Porsche team as through goes Brendan Hartley through 16 into the Peraltada and starts his...
No, this is a flyer, John.
Okay, through, finishes his flyer. Did he improve? Oh, and the 31's gone around as well for Pipo Durrani. That's in the 12 as well. That's the corner that so many people have misjudged. And he's flat spotted the tyres and he's in the wall. Oh, Pipo.
It's no improvement from Brendan Hartley. Now, it's 19, 18 seconds to go now. Both Porsches on the two car, you have to say, as well as pitted, two cars given up the... But both Audis are actually out with another crack at this.
I'd say those Audis are gaining on the number one Porsche.
It's been an improvement from Marcel Fesler. Under 26, 126 now, he's third.
Check the flags out, Graham. I think those two Audis are gaining on the Porsche.
Fesler's taken third.
And Hartley's bailed out. There'll be no improvement from the number one car, so they'll be no better than fourth position outside of the second row. Now, can it be an all-Audi front row, or will it be split? Audi Porsche needs to find round about...
Fourth for a second.
Yeah, a little bit more, actually, than that, I think, as he comes through. See what his teammate's time was. It's going to be tight. He's got a decent lap going on here. He's out of the stadium now.
This is Loic Duval.
Duval. He's already top of the charts here and goes through 25.3 he's got, and he doesn't improve. That was a 25. So that's a pole position for Audi.
Fesler bails out.
And Fesler doesn't bother.
So it's going to be... Wow. It's Audi on pole with the number 8 car, Loic Duval.
Stratton coming to the line. 42 car. Johnny Kane takes the checkered flag and stays in third position inside of row 2. Rast needs to find...
Gonzalez retains pole position. It's no improvements.
Yes.
And he retains that pole position by improving his own time, John. He's extended the lead. So Ricardo Gonzalez, great final lap from the local driver. And he has fended off Nico Lapia. Johnny Kane grabs third position on the grid from Renny Rast. So Straka Racing up to third position over the car that to this point has been unbeaten in qualifying. Renny Rast could do no better than fourth, or support no better than fourth. It is, by the way, the first full pole position of the season for the number 8 Audi.
Huh? No, I think I think
Rast
did the
4-7.
4-7?
Did he?
Not sure.
So comparison
drivers.
Yes. Yeah, no. My dad's faster than your dad. Luca De Grassi has taken pole position, but the big story is going to be in P2. We'll get to that in a moment. Let's just have the brilliant scenes from RGR Sport, the man who was promoted and put this race together.
By the way, Bruno Senna was wrong. Bruno Rast didn't have a second, didn't have a 34. He did have a second on the field. Bruno Senna was a full second faster than anybody else in that session.
Well, typically, just as you count down to me, the team come and cheer you on. Well done, number 8 pole.
Yeah, great pole, my first WEC pole, and it was so close so many times, and this time we were the lucky ones. We did the job, and this point was very important for us, so congratulations to Loic.
Good job.
Congratulations to the whole Audi team. It's a very important second phase of the championship, and we proved that we are there to fight.
Well done, Lucas.
Thank you.
They'll be delighted with that. It marks another step forward for a number 8 crew. Ollie Jarvis there congratulating his teammates, Loic Duval. But they'll be delighted. Another step forward for that number 8 crew. They've had the luck this year and they've put the laps together here. Not lucky, but just quick. And what a story for this car, John. The number 43, Ligier. Ricardo Gonzalez, great final lap there to fend off the pressure from behind from, well, potentially rather quicker drivers, but putting that together with a fantastic first qualifying lap from Bruno Senna and the hometown heroes, the 43 RGR Sport, Bimarand Ligier, pole position in their home race. 43 Ligier from the 36 Alpine, from the 42 Gibson, three different chassis in the top three, then the 26 G-Drive, Orica, Gonzalez, Lapierre, Kane and Rast to the flag.
Well, it sets up things very nicely indeed, doesn't it, for the race?
It does indeed. Lots and lots of media interest in this race. We're thoroughly enjoying our time in Mexico City. You get the impression that the growing band of fans that are here this afternoon. Well, I think we're going to be hearing a joyful, well, two joyful Brazilians, haven't we? As Bruno Senna is going to be down in pit lane, and after putting tie by the rest of the field, he's down there with Louise right now.
Well, the photographers are going to love me, because Bruno, I'm just going to grab you from that photo call. Congratulations. This, you couldn't have asked for anything better here in Mexico.
No, not at all. I mean, honestly, we've been on it since the beginning. I was pretty confident, quietly confident, that we could be on the front row. I didn't know how much we had left in us, but yesterday's pace was really, really good in FP2. So this morning was a bit disappointing as we had a small problem, so I couldn't even run. But came qualifying, I was just like, okay, we're in Mexico, just have to do the best. And Ricardo just nailed it as well. So I'm so happy. We have a nice gap in terms of performance. So I'm really looking forward to the race tomorrow.
If we're hearing cheers like that for pole, can you imagine what we're going to hear tomorrow?
Well, I hope that everything goes well tomorrow. We know that a 6-hour race is not only about being the fastest. So yeah, we have to just keep our calm and do the best we can tomorrow and hopefully bring it home.
Thank you, well done.
Thank you.
Well, a spectacular qualifying session, a fairy tale result for the 43 squad in P2, and great result too for the number 8 Audi. Audi will be delighted with that. Doesn't mean much in the championship, but it means a heck of a lot to the number 8 crew.
Great.
As they try to put a championship run together against Porsches, which did not have fault-free running, did they? And that was a run for pole by the number 2 car that just did not come off.
Yeah, it might have been close. The split times were very interesting indeed. The newspapers, the TV channels, it's just coming up to 3:15 in the afternoon here. Perfect timing for tonight's news. And Mexico will be absolutely awash with RGR Sport. The Autodromo Amandos Rodriguez, a brand new venue for the FIA World Endurance Championship. An extra 1.5 hours of practice brings us to qualifying. The baseball stadium absolutely full as the cars come right through it. And the first casualty, the 67 Ford, spinning at turn 12. There's been a topsy-turvy look to the timing sheets this week. And in GTE Arm, the Porsches have been very good indeed, but they would have to give best today to the Aston Martin Racing number 98, Gulf Racing and Abu Dhabi Proton Racing in the 86 and 88 doing their best, but the 98 Aston Martin Racing, Paul Dalla-Lama and Pedro Lamy on pole position. And the reason that there are four drivers there is that in GTE Pro, the Ferraris and the Fords could not match the pace of the normally aspirated non-turbocharged Aston Martins. Ferrari third, yes, but in first and second places, it's Aston Martin again. Aston 97 with Darren Turner and Richie Stanaway second, and the 95, Nicky Thiem and Marco Sorensen taking pole in GTE Pro. So a very green look to the front rows of the GT classes in the prototype categories. There's
three,
plenty of green.
Two, one, pit exit is green, pit exit is green.
The hybrids, of course, their batteries don't care about the altitude in the way that the internal combustion engines do. So they still make their 500 or 600 horsepower from the hybrid energy. In LMP2, fantastic run for Straka Racing with Lewis Williamson leading off their charge to third position. Signatec Alpine in second position, which might have been a little quicker if Nico Lapierre hadn't put the car in the barriers right at the end of the session, bringing out a red flag. That left a one-lap dash at the front of the field. But the fairy tale is complete for RGR Sport in their Ligier with the Nissan engine, Bruno Senna and Ricardo Gonzalez, the man behind the promotion and bringing the event here to Mexico City, along with Philippe Albuquerque, on pole position in LMP2. Massive local and national headlines there. In the hybrid prototype category, Audi had been looking strong, Porsche challenging, but the front two rows split equally between the two German competitor brands. Third, the number seven, Audi. Second, the number two, Porsche. But pole position, the Audi R18 team of Loic Duval and Lucas Degrassi, along with Ollie Jarvis. Well, that guarantees, I think, Graham, some great coverage this evening. It's a day off tomorrow. The opportunity for people to come to the circuit and the local interest absolutely fulfilled, and we know how mad they are for their local sport here. They will want to turn out and support. And we've got plenty of South American interest at the sharp end of the hybrid field as well.
Huge level of interest. We say the two pole interviews, both Brazilian drivers from P1 and P2. For me, in P2, the two standout performances, Bruno Senna with that fantastic qualifying lap and a defensive run, an improving run from Ricardo Gonzalez under pressure from professional drivers behind, he fended it off.
So that's qualifying done. We have our four pole sitters. We go racing for the 6 hours of Mexico tomorrow, live here from Mexico City.